Today, we're going to talk about batteries for your solar system. Our main focus is going to be our solar pumps, but this is also applicable to other off-grid solar systems or anytime you want to hook up a battery in parallel or series. So in front of me, I have two lead acid batteries. These are flooded lead acid batteries and they're not sealed. And so they have the caps on the top, which if you ever need to take off, you can check the level of the liquid and add more water as necessary. There's other types called sealed lead acid. Those don't have the opening and they're sealed with a vent. And so they don't ever need maintenance. They're not gonna lower in water. You're not gonna have to open them and check the water level every once in a while. They're slightly more expensive, and these are much more readily available, the ones with the opening at the top. The other type are gel batteries. Instead of the flooded type where we have liquid acid inside of it, they have a mesh material which absorbs the acid and sits in between the plates. That way they can use less acid in the battery, and in case it's ever breached or damaged, it's not going to spill all over the place. Those get quite a bit more expensive, but they all basically work the same. They're all lead acid batteries, and they output about 12 volts, and that range is anywhere from 11.5 volts up to around 13 volts when they're fully charged. Both solar panels and batteries operate off of DC voltage. If we take a look here, there's both a positive and negative terminal on each battery. As I mentioned, they're called 12 volt batteries, but that voltage really ranges depending on the state of charge. If we take a look here and measure from plus to minus with our multimeter, we have about 12.7 volts. That means this battery for this specific type of flooded lead acid is about 3/4 charged. As we use charge out of it, that voltage will drop, and as we're recharging it, that voltage will rise. There's various tables for your different battery chemistries for the state of charge depending on voltage. If you look down below in the description of the video, we have a link to our website where we list various battery types and the state of charge depending on voltage. Take a look at that, find your battery, and you'll be able to quickly measure with a multimeter the state of charge of your battery. There's two main configurations for hooking up your batteries. There's parallel connections and there's series connections. For parallel connections, when you connect the positive to positive and the negative to negative, you're maintaining the same voltage output, but you're doubling the current capacity and doubling the current capability. When we connect them in series, that's when we're connecting plus to minus and then coming off the two plus terminals. And from there, we're doubling the voltage, but maintaining the same current capacity and the same current capability. Depending on your exact application, you may be connecting batteries in series and then taking sets of those batteries and connecting them in parallel to create your battery bank. Here, I'm going to show you, first by hooking up the batteries in series, how that affects the voltage output. So from battery one to battery two, we have the positive terminal hooked up to the negative terminal. And now we end up with two terminals, a plus and a minus. Now if we take a look and hook up across the two, our multimeter, we'll be able to see our voltage doubled to 25 volts. And there's not an easy way to show that the current stayed the same, but if we'd measure the current capability across these, it'd be about the same as one battery alone. So that's a series connection. Next, I'll show you a parallel connection. In this case, we need two jumpers. I'm going to hook that up right now. Now we have our batteries hooked up in parallel. We have a jumper from plus to plus, and we have a jumper from minus to minus. Now if we measure across one of the batteries, plus to plus, and we look on our multimeter, we can see it's 12.5 volts. Basically the same voltage we had before, even though we have two in parallel. If we were to test the current carrying capability from plus to minus, we would notice it's twice as high. We're able to put twice as much current reserve. One unit of measure for batteries is voltage. Normally they come in either 6 volt or 12 volt batteries. The other unit of measurement is current. That's measured in amp hours of current. So normally that's amp hours. So this battery is right around 100 amp hours of current stored in it. That means basically it could produce 100 amps for 1 hour. Now it doesn't quite work like that. You'll have to look at your manufacturer's specs in order to determine how they rate their batteries over time. In general, the faster you pull the current out, the less capability it has, and the slower and longer you pull the current out, the longer it has. So generally, they're going to spec it over 5 to 10 hours of drawing out that current. So while you can't pull 100 amps for an hour, you could pull 100 amp hours over a 10-hour period or so. Depending on the type of your battery and the size of the battery, you'll have a different power storage capacity. These ones are about 100 amp hour. Also, depending on the chemistry of your battery, it'll have a recommended discharge amount. That's the amount you don't want to go past in order to prevent damaging your battery. In general, batteries are rated for full lifetime at around 50% depth of discharge. That means you could use 50% of the capacity, in this case, about 50 amp hours. Below that, you're going to prematurely degrade your battery. So a battery like this would last probably around 400 cycles at 50% depth of discharge. If you went all the way up to 80%, using 80% of the capacity, you may only get 200 cycles off your battery. If you look at your manufacturer spec, they'll have a data sheet that tells you the amount of discharge you can do and the amount of cycles it'll last at that depth of discharge. We've talked about voltage, we've talked about current, let's talk about power and how those two relate with the load that you're operating. You may have seen this before. P equals IV. That means power equals current times voltage. With this formula, you can basically calculate the amount of time you're going to get to operate off your batteries. That's another way to say it is watts equals to amps times volts. So let's take a look at a 100 watt load. If we're running at 12 volts, that means we're drawing 8.3 amps. That's 8.3 times 12 equals 100. So that means with the 100 watt load hooked up to a single battery here, we have about 50 amp hours of stored current. If we're drawing it at 8.3 for a 100 watt load, that means we could operate it around 6 hours without going past a 50% state of charge of our batteries. You can use this basic formula to calculate anything you need with related to how long your batteries are going to last at a given load. Okay, so that's the basics on batteries. Let's talk about now if you want to hook those up to your solar panels. Solar panels come in two main styles. They're referred to as 12 volt panels and 24 volt panels. In general, 100 watt panels and around that range are 12 volt, and the larger panels are generally 24 volts, but they're not actually outputting 12 volts and 24 volts. We'll talk about a 100 watt panel here. 100 watt panel is gonna produce max power around 18 volts. That provides a bit of extra voltage in order to charge the batteries. If they were only outputting 12 volts, you wouldn't be able to be pushing the power into the batteries. It needs that voltage differential from 18 down to around 12 to 13 volts in order to get the power to flow into the batteries to store it for later. In general, you want to match the number of panels to the number of batteries. So if you have a 12 volt panel and you have two in series, then when you want to use two batteries in series. If you have a single 24 volt panel, then you want to use two batteries in series again. If you just want to hook up one panel, one 100 watt panel at 12 volts to a battery, then you'd use a single battery. And if you want to add more batteries on for more capacity, you'd hook extra batteries up in parallel versus extra in series. There's four main voltages for battery banks today: 12 volts, 24 volts, 36, 48. There's even some higher voltage ones coming out, but they're not as common right now for your general off-the-shelf charge controllers. In general, a 24 volt and a 48 volt system is a good way to go. And you'll need to look at your other equipment in order to decide with what voltage you want to go with. In general, when you go to higher power systems past a kilowatt, you really want to start going higher in voltage and getting away from your 12 to 24 volt systems. You want to take that jump up to 48 volt in order to minimize the amount of current you're pulling through the batteries into your downstream units. The link between your solar panels and your batteries is what's called a charge controller. There's a couple of different types. Right here are solar well pumps. These have a built-in charge controller. And so you hook up your solar panels to the controller, and then you hook up your batteries. It takes care of the rest, charging and discharging them to operate the pump as needed. If you're not doing a well pump and you're going for an off-grid system, here we have two smaller charge controllers. On my right here, I have what's called a maximum power point tracking charge controller. This is slightly more efficient than the standard PWM, pulse width modulated charge controller, but they both operate basically in the same way. They take the power from your panels, and input it into the battery. And as they're doing that, they monitor the state of charge of the batteries through voltage and cut off the charging when the batteries get up to a specified voltage in order to prevent overcharging and boiling of your acid inside. Most of them also have a load. And for smaller loads, like lights and other continuously running appliances, you can hook them up to this load and it'll cut off when they get to a specified state of charge. A lot of the controllers have a setting you can adjust where that cutoff voltage is. That prevents over discharging your battery and shortening the life of them. With our solar pump controllers, this is built in, and we go for about a 50% state of charge in order to shut it off in order to get the optimum lifetime out of your batteries. I changed these over. Now we're in a series configuration. We have plus to minus, and off of the two ends, we have the 24 volts that we're expecting. And right now it's about 25 volts. So off of the two sides, we need to attach other leads if we're gonna connect them to something. In this case, connect one lead to the minus. And the other lead to the plus. So here I have two leads hooked up, one to the positive, one to the negative, with the batteries in series, giving me about 25 volts. From here, I can take the two leads and I can hook them into the battery inputs on the charge controller, or I can hook them up to the terminals on our solar pump controller. And from there, the controller takes care of the rest with the panels hooked up. It takes the power from the panels, puts it into the batteries, monitors the state of charge, and then draws power from it needed in order to operate our well pump. Also on the controller, they have load terminals. These can hook up small electrical loads like lights or fans. Or once the voltage drops too low on the batteries, it cuts off the load to prevent over discharge. Usually they target right around 50% capacity, but it's adjustable in the charge controllers. And in our system, we go for 50% discharge. That gives maximum life to the batteries and provides for a good number of amp hours running throughout the day. When you hook up your batteries to your charge controllers, you do want to make sure you remove at least one of the leads from your battery to make sure there's no voltage present on your line. There's 25 volts here, and with the two big batteries hooked up, we have a lot of current capability behind it. You can see there's a lot of arc going on if we touch these two together. If that touches your metallic ring, it can weld to it, heat up, burn your finger, or damage other hardware as you're hooking everything up. Just like batteries, panels connect in a very similar way in order to get the right current and voltage. If we want more voltage, we connect panels in series. To do that, most panels have MC4 connectors, and so we can go from one positive of one panel to the negative of the adjacent panel, hook them together, and out of the two ends, we're going to get double the voltage and the same current. Also with MC4 connectors, there's what's called a Y parallel connector. It has two male connectors, and another one has two female connectors. For a 24 volt system, we want to hook up two panels in series. To do that, we'll take the plus and the minus, hook them up together. Then we end up with two leads, one positive, one negative. If we hook up the multimeter, we can see they're outputting above 24 volts like we talked about earlier, but this is perfect for your 24 volt system. If we look at a quick example, here we have four solar panels. And in this case, for our 24 volt system using 100 watt, 12 volt panels, we want to connect them in series and parallel in order to hook up to our charge controller. For one set, we connect plus to minus using the attached MC4 connectors, again, doubles the voltage. And then in order to double the current, we connect them in parallel. We connect plus to plus using a Y connector, and we connect minus to minus, again, using the other Y connector. Then we have two single terminals, one minus, one plus. From here, we can attach our extension wire and bring it down and run that extension wire either into our charge controller for our solar pump or to our standalone charge controller. There's the terminals on here, solar plus, solar minus. Now we essentially have 24 volts coming out to match with our two batteries. That goes into the controller. Now we have a match system. Our panels match our batteries. This is a very basic setup. Depending on your exact charge controller, you may have to do a set more in series if you have a higher voltage controller, or more in parallel if you have a lower voltage controller. Most of them come with an instruction manual, and we'll talk about how to size your solar array for your batteries. So that's the basics for batteries for a solar system. It's not too complicated when you break it down into its individual components. That's the battery, that's the solar panel, the charge controller, and your load. If you match them all together and make sure the voltage for your panels matches the voltage for your batteries, matching what your charge controller expects, it's simple to plan out your system, and it's simple to hook up your batteries and get operating right away. So that's a general overview of batteries and solar panels for your off-grid system. For our solar well pumps, we mainly operate at 24 and 48 volts. All of our systems come with a detailed user manual, and it talks exactly about how to hook up your panels for each of your configurations. Here we're seeing two 12-volt panels in series, and down below for a 36-volt system, we have three solar panels in series and two sets in parallel. Following this simple guide, you'll be able to hook up your solar panels to your batteries if you need them in order to operate at nighttime and on cloudy days. Our systems are very easy to use and allow you to take over control of your water source by pumping water using solar power and adding batteries if you need them to pump when the sun's not shining. And if you have any questions, feel free to give us a call and we're happy to answer them in real time in order to get you set up with your solar pump system. Visit us at rpssolarpumps.com for more information.